Hi, everyone. My name is Dr. Aidan Sharkey. I'm an attending anesthesiologist at the Beth Israel Medical Center in Boston, Massachusetts. And today we are discussing the third and final part of our lecture series on basic cardiac point of care ultrasound. The key takeaways of this talk would be to discuss the apical four-chamber view, the subcostal four-chamber, and subcostal inferior vena cava views that are used for cardiac point of care ultrasound. We will discuss image acquisition along with normal sonoanatomy and how we may utilize these views in patient care settings. Starting off with the apical four-chamber view, and this view can be challenging to master. However, it is a very important view for chamber and valve function quantification. To improve our imaging windows, it is imperative to optimize patient positioning by placing the patient in the left lateral position, if possible. You'll also need to increase the depth of the image in order to obtain this view. To obtain this view, the ultrasound probe is placed at the point of maximal apical pulsation, which is generally the fourth or fifth intercostal space in the mid-clavicular line. The probe indicator should be facing towards the patient's left shoulder, as indicated by the blue arrow in this image. The standard view obtained in this window should appear as depicted in this video clip and cartoon representation. Here we can clearly visualize all four heart chambers, that is the two atria and two ventricles, along with the mitral and tricuspid valves. This view has many basic and advanced uses. Assessment of biventricular function is one such basic use of the apical four-chamber view. The function of the left and right ventricles can be qualitatively assessed by eyeballing cardiac contractility. The video loop on the left shows normal left and right ventricular function, while the clip on the right demonstrates poor contractility of both ventricles, and therefore a patient with reduced biventricular function. As stated previously, the apical four-chamber view has many advanced uses that are beyond the scope of this lecture, but include quantitative biventricular and atria assessment, valvular assessment for regurgitant and stenotic lesions, as well as assessing for diastolic dysfunction and estimating patients' pulmonary artery systolic pressures. All of these can be evaluated in a single view, making this one of the most important views in advanced transthoracic echocardiography. Our next view that we are going to discuss is the subcostal four-chamber view. Obtaining this view can be uncomfortable for patients, and again, patient positioning is important for optimizing windows and image quality. Ideally, the patient should be in the supine position with the knees bent so as to relax the abdominal musculature. And if possible, an inspiratory hold can sometimes be useful for image optimization as it serves to bring cardiac structures closer to the probe. In order to obtain this view, the ultrasound probe is placed in the subxiphoid region with the probe indicator facing towards the patient's left side at approximately the 3 o'clock position, as indicated by the blue arrow in this diagram. Our standard view in this window should appear as depicted in this video loop and cartoon representation, where we should be able to identify the liver, the pericardium, along with the two atria and two ventricles of the heart. This view is similar to the apical four-chamber view in terms of its ability to grossly assess biventricular function, along with some advanced uses such as valvular assessment. It can also be useful in thoracic trauma, where parasternal windows may not be able to be accessed, or if there is ongoing resuscitation efforts limiting front of chest access. This view is also particularly good for evaluating free fluid in the pericardial space, as shown in these videos, where we see free fluid in the pericardial space depicted by the yellow arrows. In both video clips, we can see a circumferential fluid collection, and one of the distinguishing features suggesting possible tamponade physiology is right ventricular diastolic collapse, as seen on the video to the right of the screen. The final view that we're going to discuss today is the subcostal inferior vena cava view. This view is often used in patients to estimate right atrial pressures and also to assess for fluid responsiveness. In order to obtain this view, we usually start from our subcostal four-chamber view and then rotate the probe approximately 90 degrees counterclockwise so that the indicator is facing towards the patient's head or the 12 o'clock position, as indicated by the blue arrow in this diagram. Gentle rocking of the probe will then allow image optimization and it'll allow the IVC to come into view. In this view, we should be able to identify the liver, inferior vena cava, and the right atrium. It is very important to see the inferior vena cava merging into the right atrium, as the abdominal aorta is also in this vicinity and can be easily mistaken for the IVC. When looking at the inferior vena cava, one of the aspects we evaluate is its size. The normal IVC diameter in spontaneously breathing patients is less than 2.1 centimeters, which indicates low right atrial pressures and a patient who would tolerate intravenous fluid administration, as seen in the video loop on the left. Conversely, an IVC diameter greater than 2.1 centimeters indicates elevated right atrial pressures, and this patient may not benefit from further fluid administration, as shown in the video loop on the right. Another feature we examine when visualizing the inferior vena cava is collapsibility throughout the respiratory cycle, to again give us an estimate of right atrial pressure. In spontaneously breathing patients, a greater than 50% collapsibility of the IVC with inspiration, as seen on image A, suggests low right atrial pressure. Whereas collapsibility of less than 50%, as seen in image B, suggests elevated right atrial pressures. That concludes our third and final lecture on basic cardiac point of care ultrasound today. In summary, we discussed the apical four-chamber view, the subcostal four-chamber view, and the subcostal IVC view. We talked about how we obtain these views. We described the sonoanatomy and also showed how we utilize the images obtained for patient care. Thank you for watching, and I hope you found this topic helpful.